Hey guys, I wanted to make another samurai information video similar to the one I put out a while back about the samurai tradition of head taking. However, this time I want to focus on a topic that I've been meaning to get to for a while now, and also is one that several of you have already requested, that being titles, ranks, and classes of feudal Japan, more importantly, in the Kamakura and Muromachi periods. In many of my videos, I discuss a lot of these already, yet in some regards, there is much more information that could be said to help clear things up. So this video will not only work to compile info, but also expand details. Now, it is important to understand that these roles changed over time, just as Japan did through the ages. Thus, what I want to do first is set up the structure of society during the Kamakura Shogunate, and then follow it up by illustrating the changes that came later during the rule of the Ashikaga. Unfortunately, I have decided to not discuss the political structure of the Tokugawa Shogunate in this video, as I don't want to make this video super long, and on top of that, I already plan on discussing it heavily once we move into the Edo period in the main series. So then, let's get started. Now, I figure the best place to begin is to examine the actual classes of feudal Japan during the reign of the Kamakura Shogunate, in which then we can work to dissect each tier of society. A typical view of the classes in feudal Japan can be broken down into three categories. You have the upper class, the emperor and his court, the middle class, the samurai, and the lower class, commoners. Although simply stopping there would be incorrect, as there is much more subdivision and diversity. So I figure the best way to do this is to start at the bottom and work our way up. Keep in mind, I'm showcasing this as it was supposed to have functioned, not as it actually did, a matter I'm sure you are all well aware of, and which I will elaborate more on later in the video regardless. The bottom classes, the majority of the population in feudal Japan, were made up of the common peoples, although they too have their own rank in society. At the very bottom, lower than anyone else, are the merchants, those who buy and sell goods usually produced by others. Above them are the artisans, those who actually craft the goods that many of the merchants sell. Their products range from dishes to swords, armor, fans, clothing. Most things made in Japan come from this class. Surprisingly though, above them were the farmers and fishermen, those who grew and gathered the sustenance for all to live. And although they can generally be seen at the top of the lower classes of society, there is one more often overlooked group that are truly above the rest of the common people, although they exist in an odd state of fusion with the rest. These being the Ashugaru, common foot soldiers who began making their first appearances following the Mongol invasions of Japan in the late 1200s, when Japan needed to reassess its military structure. A vast majority of the Ashigaru were only part-time soldiers, as many of them were commoners who were drafted into military service when a lord required an army. Yet there were more permanent Ashigaru, who were full-time soldiers, often assigned as personal guards for lords. The interesting thing about Ashigaru is that they were some of the only people in feudal Japan who were able to achieve upward mobility in regard to their class, meaning that an Ashigaru who exhibits exemplary service may be promoted to that of a samurai by his lord, moving his entire family up into the warrior class and giving his family its own name. Although it is here we begin moving into the middle classes of feudal Japanese society, the warrior or samurai class. At the very bottom of the samurai class were the samurai who, for lack of a better term, were unemployed. These were the ronin, masterless samurai. They still held all the rights and privileges of the samurai, thus making their position higher than that of simple ashigaru, yet they in all reality had no authority. They simply were made to take up odd jobs or wander the countryside until perhaps they would find their way into the service of another lord. Above the ronin were the core samurai, the real meat of the warrior class. Found in service to a lord, they were the pinnacle fighting soldiers found throughout feudal Japan, trained from birth in both martial skill and political prowess. For the samurai, family was everything, and whoever led your family was the person in charge of your allegiance, ergo, which clan you served. These family leaders swore their loyalty to a shugo, the military land governors who ruled swaths of territory throughout the country, not necessarily entire provinces. Before the samurai took control of the country with the establishment of the Kamakura Shogunate in 1192, the position of land governor was known as kokushi, and was not generally held by someone who belonged to the warrior class, but rather the nobility. This of course changed when the shogunate took control and reshaped the country, changing the role over to the shugo, who belonged to the warrior class. Thus, the position changed to that of a military land governor. The shugo often belonged to a mighty samurai family, who were recognized by the shogun for their service, and thereby given land to rule over in exchange for their loyalty. And backtracking for a second, we can see how the bulk of a shugo's strength was not only made up of his own family, but also that of lesser families loyal to him, altogether forming a clan. These loyal lesser families are often referred to as vassals, with prominent samurai figures in service to a lord often being dubbed retainers. Above the many shugo was the shogun and his shogunate. It was the shogun who was the ruler of the warrior class, and who each samurai owed their loyalty to. The shogun held the ability to not only command the shugo, but also, and perhaps more importantly, the ability to distribute land. Giving richer swaths of territory to your more loyal supporters helps to ensure your strength, while taking land away from your enemies works to limit the power of your rivals. This establishes stability across the country, as the system serves to preserve order among the clans. The shogunate or bakufu itself was essentially its own government, although in the case of the Kamakura, it was rather small when compared to the shogunates that would come later. Although that would eventually come to change throughout the rule of the Kamakura shogunate, as their government structure developed from that of perhaps minuscule to later much more expansive. At the top was of course the shogun, yet below him laid important regents known as shikane, which is important to know as the original Hojo family were shikane to the Minamoto, and eventually came to dominate the inner workings of the shogunate, essentially puppeting the shogun himself. In fact, many of the positions within the Kamakura shogunate, which I will soon detail, were in fact developed and implemented by the shikane. Alongside the shikane, we have the rensho, who were assistants to the shikane. Below the shikane would be the hyojoshu, who were a council of judiciaries who enforced shogunal law and policy. However, it is underneath them that the government splits apart into two branches, one to govern central affairs and one to govern the rest of the country. At the top of the central administration, we have the kumonjo and mandakoro positions, which managed finances and wealth intake from the various provinces of Japan. Ranked underneath them was the manchujo, a position which worked to take inquiries and settle disputes to claims brought before them, usually bringing them to the attention of the hyojoshu. And it was beneath them that we find the samurai dokoro, which were essentially the official army of the shogunate, safeguarding its well-being and exercising justice to those who break shogunal laws. And finally, below the samurai dokoro was the hikitsuke, who worked to develop cases for the hyojoshu. Now, for the branch that managed local affairs across the country, at the top we find the Kyoto Shugo, the official in charge of the affairs in the capital and roughly all of central Japan. Keep in mind that the Kamakura shogunate was of course located in Kamakura, and not Kyoto like the Ashikaga would be later. Thus, the shogunate needed to maintain authority over the capital and central region from afar. The Kyoto Shugo worked alongside with the Rokuhara Tandai, a form of secret police which exercised shogunal authority. Below the Kyoto Shugo were the Chinzen Bugyo and the Chinzai Tandai, who worked to maintain stability in the west. Their original purpose was that of rooting out all support for opposing Minamoto family members. Yet, we can see that as time went on, their focus shifted to military defense when the Mongols invaded in the late 1200s. Underneath them were the Oshu Sobugyo, who worked to maintain stability in the northern regions. Beneath them were simply all of the Shugo, the military land governors who ruled over swaths of the country. And finally, below the Shugo were the Jito, essentially stewards in charge of many provincial affairs such as collecting taxes. And though originally they would be established as independent from the Shugo, in time the Shugo would come to simply dominate them. Of course, the Shogun and the entire Shogunate was still supposed to be subservient to the Emperor, the divine ruler of all Japan. The Emperor and his imperial court were meant to be the real political leaders of the country, along with other noble families at the top, known as Kuge. And I use words like suppose and meant because, as we know, the Emperor and the imperial court actually had very little power during the reign of the Kamakura Shogunate, as their positions were reduced to little more than that of figureheads, while true power came from the Shogunate. So now that you have a good idea of Japanese society during the reign of the Kamakura Shogunate, let us move on to the Muromachi period, when the Ashikaga came to rule. When the Ashikaga Shogunate came to power, the first main difference that can be seen, aside from the fact that the Shogunate was now located in Kyoto instead of Kamakura, was the actual inner workings of the shogunal government, which was heavily reconfigured. The Ashikaga would still keep the overall framework of the Kamakura Shogunate with its two-branch system, yet the most immediate alteration we can see is the removal of the Shikane, the shogunal regents. This change can be seen as arguably both a positive and a negative, as now there weren't powerful families within the Shogunate puppeting the power of the Shogun. Yet this at the same time allowed for many powerful families outside of the Shogunate to rise and exert heavy influence over the Shogun and Kyoto politics. So without the Shikane, both branches of the government simply answered to the Shogun, and once again we have the branch which managed central affairs and the branch which managed local affairs. Right away, we can see another big change is the addition of the new Kanrei position. If we remember from videos past, the position of Kanrei was the shogunal deputy, someone who served to manage many of the inner workings within their particular administration. The position of Kanrei was often given to the shugo of one of the shogunate's most mighty and loyal clans. For example, the Hosokawa in central Japan would come to be given the status of Kyoto Kanrei, and in the Kanto region, the Uesugi would hold the Kanto Kanrei title. So, with that said, let us dive into the actual branches and see what has changed from the previous shogunate. For the central administration, at the top we now have the Kyoto Kanrei, who of course served to oversee the rest of the central administration. Below the Kanrei was the Hyōjōshu, the Council of Judiciaries, although now the Hikitsuke position was moved up to more formally work alongside the Hyōjōshu. The Mandakoro, who still managed finances and intake from various provinces. The Samurai Dokoro. Then, finally, Manchujo, who still worked to take inquiries and settle disputes to claims brought before them. Although the central administration still consisted mostly of the same roles as seen before with the Kamakura government, the local administration can be observed to have went through more drastic alterations. At the top was now the Kamakura Kubo, a shogunal official who maintained authority within the seat of the old shogunate in Kamakura. He worked alongside the Kanrei of Kanto to ensure stability over what can be seen as the second most important region in all of feudal Japan. The Kyushu Tandai, Oshu Tandai, and Ushu Tandai. The Tandais worked to exert shogunal authority and ensure stability over various specific regions of Japan. The Shugo, the many provincial military governors. But now, parallel to the Shugo were the Shugodai, officials appointed to manage their territory when the Shugo himself was away from his home province. And finally, below the Shugo were again Jito. Yet now, similarly to the Shogudai, there were also Jitodai. These many changes to the shogunal government were meant to make the shogunate stronger and more efficient. However, even though the Ashikaga had revamped their governing structure, it was not enough to actually save themselves and keep their rule intact. As we know, the Muromachi period is most well known for the outbreak of the Sengoku Jidai, when the country essentially went to war with itself. As we witnessed with the Kamakura Shogunate, the emperor and imperial court held little to no real power, allowing the shogunate to reign supreme. Although the situation for the Ashikaga Shogunate would be vastly different. As we saw in the main series, their inefficient shoguns, lack of core territory, and easily swayed nature caused their authority to gradually decline over time. Thus, by the end of the Onin War in 1477, the weakness of the Ashikaga Shogunate was truly exposed for all to see. Thus, many ambitious shugo became the first of the daimyo. As they began attempting to expand their influence through military conquest, unopposed by the shogunate, which was supposed to keep the peace. The daimyo of the Sengoku Jidai became entirely self-sufficient, holding complete military and economic power over their territory, unshackled by the restraints of the shogunate. And thus, we have caught up to the point we are now at in the main series. I hope this has served to fill in any gaps previously left by the main series, and worked to give further detail into various classes, titles, and ranks that have been brought up throughout my videos thus far. Throughout the rest of the main Sengoku Jidai and later Edo series, we will see further changes come politically, along with the establishment of new titles and ranks. Lastly, I also want to mention that sometimes these titles and ranks can understandably become confusing, and I'd be lying if I said that even I had a fair grip on some of these terms covered. So, if you know any information I may have missed, or anything you wish to discuss or address further, please do so in the comments section. I love engaging with you all, and I feel we can all work together to better understand history. So, as always, thank you for watching, and don't forget to like, subscribe, and ring that notification bell if you enjoyed this video and found it to be most informative.